As you start a new painting project, the most important setting is the one which says compute tangent space per fragment. While the documentation states this is only relative to the Unreal, this is in fact relative to all renderers that use MikkT. This includes Blender, Unity, Unreal, and others. So if you will eventually use your model, or more precisely your normal map, in another rendering program, you need to make sure you set this to enabled if it uses MikkT. If you don't know what MikkT is, click on the card in the top right corner or click the information bubble icon later to get the link to a video which explains it well enough. Moving back to the top, we find a set of templates. The templates loads in different shader models to set up a bunch of shader channels to send data over to the said shader model. These channels can be found listed under the texture set settings, where you can add and remove channels as you see fit. You are likely to need the channels like emission or opacity at some point, and this is where you can find them. Most of the templates has a PBR prefix to its name, which is an acronym for physically based rendering. Most of the major licensing game engines these days use PBR shaders, but there is no set in stone way of interpreting the data, so different rendering programs use various means of doing so. But the PBR templates are not really vital when it comes to working inside Painter, as it can convert maps back and forth to suit any export needs, indifferent to which template has been used to actually create them. Nowadays, Painter will default to a metallic roughness template, and even though programs like Unity use metal glossiness templates, this again is not an issue, as these maps can easily be converted. The normal map format allows you to choose between the OpenGL method and the DirectX method for interpreting the tangent Y value of the vertex normal. OpenGL and DirectX interpret the tangent Y value oppositely, so what this normal map format really asks is if the tangent Y value 1.0 means upwards or downwards. So as an example, if Painter is set to a OpenGL method and has the normal map baked against that specific orientation, a DirectX rendering environment like Unreal will shade the surface as if the light entered from the opposite direction, because it interprets the value oppositely. Most rendering environments gives the user the option to flip the tangent float value, so this setting is not really vital, but it is convenient for the artist to get this right the first time so the flipping switch won't be necessary later. Next up is the create a texture set per UDIM tile checkbox. If you don't know what UDIM is, then you are not using it and you should set this to disabled. But to keep it short, the UDIM technique creates additional UV ranges outside the usual single UV range, and the artist can then place UV islands into these other ranges and create textures unique to them without having to assign them to unique materials. The textures will not repeat, mirror, or clamp outside the ranges as they usually do. The convenience of UDIM is that it allows the artist to easily work with multiple smaller sets of textures, which combined into a single UV range would create a much larger and computationally intensive texture. For instance, instead of having to work on a 16K by 16K texture, the artist can instead work with 8 2048 by 2048 textures without creating 8 different materials and clutter the material hierarchy within the modeling software. Painter will create a texture set for each UV range that has a UV island in it, so in this case it would create 8 texture sets. Not all rendering environments support it, so you need to look that up before deciding on using this technique. The document resolution sets the amount of text holes generated within the width and height of the UV range. In other words, it sets the resolution of the texture. Take note, this has nothing to do with the texture resolution of the baked textures. It only has to do with the resolution of the textures in the layer stack, and this can be changed. The size of the baked textures will be decided in the baking settings later on. Finally, if you have used any other programs to bake textures, these can be imported and connected to the texture set to have a visual effect across the model's geometry, and also be used as baking data within Painter to further generate texture types. For it to be self-assigned to the various shader channels, the naming convention displayed on screen needs to be followed. First, you need to write the name of the texture set or the material within your modeling software. followed by an underscore and the texture type name in small letters and separated by underscores where needed. If you don't follow this naming convention, the texture files can still be found within the textures shelf, where you can connect them yourself by dragging them into the texture set settings. This time I will be using Unity. Notice as I pick the Unity template, the calculate checkbox remains unchecked, and this is something that was decided by Algorithmic before Unity switched to MikkT, so we will need to enable this ourselves. Now, if you have made changes to your model within your modeling software, you can reload your model to have these changes take effect in Painter by going to Edit and Project Configurations. Model properties which can be updated are model geometry, UV layout, and materials. But you need to click the Select button, select the file and open for it to actually reload. You will find a Bake Mesh Maps button under the texture set settings. In the panel on the left, you will see a column of buttons which each represents a single texture type, with additional checkboxes within them. The checkboxes lets you decide individually between the texture types whether they will be baked or not, and the two buttons on top lets you quickly enable or disable all the texture types. Moving to the bottom, you can close the baking window, bake all the texture sets with the current settings, or bake just the selected texture set with the current setting. By clicking the buttons themselves, you can adjust the baking settings for said texture type. But the default settings for the texture type specific parameters are usually good enough to get you started, so these can be left as is. But they are well documented in the online documentation, which is worth a quick read whenever you find some spare time. The most important settings are the ones which are found in the common category up top, as these are settings which affects all the texture types. The output settings is the texture density of the baked textures, so every texture type which is set to bake will be generated at this texture resolution. Dilation width clamps the color past the UV island border in the amount of texels set by this parameter. This can help in eliminating mipmap downsampling errors, such as holes along the edges on the lower resolutions of the mipmaps. The higher the resolution of the texture, the higher this number should be to compensate. But there is also the Apply Diffusion button, which will interpolate the edge colors of the UV islands and create connected gradients between them until it fills all the empty UV space. Dilation width, on the other hand, clamps the solid color without a gradient behavior, and it is only to a set texel amount. So if Apply Diffusion is on, the dilation width parameter has no meaningful function, and it can just as well be set to the default one value. And this is where you will reference your high poly sources to bake from. If you click on the file icon to the right, you can add one or as many high poly sources as you want. You can remove them individually with the minus button. The Use Cage checkbox enables and disables the cage model function. By clicking the file icon, you can navigate to the cage file you want to use. And shortly explained, the cage model is a projection source reference for the rays that scans the surface of the high poly objects to generate the textures which will be projected onto the low poly objects. I can't compress all the do's and don'ts into this video, so you will need to learn more about that elsewhere. The max frontal and rear distance sliders sets the ray projection distance from the low poly objects if no cage model has been referenced and enabled. For the baker to be able to see the geometry of the high poly objects and create textures, the high poly surface has to be between the boundary of these two parameters. If the cage checkbox is enabled, these sliders has no function since you are using the cage geometry as a projection source instead. Relative to bounding box sets the max frontal and rear distance parameter to scale relative to the scale of the entire model instead of the individual objects. So each ray is projected from the exact same distance from each vertex. If a cage is being used, this parameter has no function. The average normal option is also relative to the frontal and rear distance parameter. If it is on, the projection ray will project on the average angle of the connected faces instead of the perpendicular angle of each face. This sets the angle of the ray cast where both faces are visible even when the connected faces form an angle sharper than 90 degrees. And most of the time, you will want this to be on. The ignore backface checkbox tells the baker whether to continue or stop the projection ray when it hits the backface of a polygon. If it is unchecked, the ray will stop, and if it is checked, the ray will continue. And this can be used to eliminate some ray projection issues. Match informs the baker whether or not objects within the low poly model should be allowed to scan objects within the high poly model reference that has non-matching names. If this is set to match by name, the projection rays from the object head mouth teeth low will only scan the object name head mouth teeth high within the high poly model reference. However, the object head mouth tongue high will not be scanned by the rays of head mouth teeth low objects as the name does not fully match. This function was made to eliminate the need to explode the models to prevent projection rays overlapping other unrelated objects and project these geometries into the normal map. Take note that the ambient occlusion rays will ignore this setting and occlude light across different objects as per usual. This is because the ambient occlusion is made in a separate ray pass which is unrelated to these settings. If you don't want to occlude light between objects, this can be disabled in the ambient occlusion texture type settings by setting self-occlusion to only same mesh name. Match by name and cage works together, so the cage geometry that overlaps other objects will not have these foreign objects be visible in the baked textures of the low poly surface. This makes it a lot easier to iterate on the models since there is no need to re-explode it and realign it with the high poly model later. The high poly model suffix and low poly model suffix allows you to tell the baker which words to identify when matching the high poly objects to the low poly objects. Take the example above. Since it is set to underscore high and underscore low, the baker is able to match the names of head mouth teeth low and head mouth teeth high and isolate these objects. The suffix strings allows you to set the suffix to your own preference, in case you have your own naming conventions you want to follow, like underscore h and underscore low or l. The anti-aliasing method increases the numbers of texels in the UV range by a set multiplication to further refine the detail during the baking process. It then finds the average color shared between these smaller points and uses it to color the actual texel. This lessens the effect of pixelated borders between high color contrast texels as they instead use the middle ground within the area. Increasing the anti-aliasing factor will increase the time of the baking procedure. When you are baking for the first time, it is wise to turn the anti-aliasing off and disable all the texture types but the normal map. Especially the thickness map takes a very long time to be created, and it is a waste of time to wait around for it if it turns out there is something wrong with the projection distance or cage model. Keeping the texture size at 1024x1024 and the anti-aliasing to none will result in a very jagged texture map, but the only thing you should care about now is that the projection rays does not render foreign objects into parts of the normal map where it doesn't belong, and that the rays are at a far enough distance to see all the geometry of the high poly model. It is also wise to turn off apply diffusion when doing this, as it will create gradients for the normal map as well, which can hide holes within the normal map as a result of bad projection distances. If there appears to be a problem with the bake at this point, there is a video that can help you eliminate these errors in the card displaying on the top right of the video. Once you got a successful bake, you can enable all the other textures and increase the resolution and the anti-aliasing factor to get clearer textures.